Amen. You may be seated. We will not be continuing the What is a Healthy Church series tonight. That will be reserved for next week. Just wanted to say a few words from the text, John 1. If you have your Bibles, would you turn there? Maybe just before we get to John 1, which will really reveal the message that we proclaim, that Kyle and Della and many other workers, as mentioned, labor in. I just wanted to read something in light of suffering, what Kyle and Della challenged us with. Don't be afraid to suffer for Christ. And if you ever want to read an encouraging section of scripture, I would encourage you to read Hebrews 11. And then I want you to listen to this phrase. So we're going to get to John 1 in a second, but I at least wanted to start here. This is at the end of the Hall of Faith, mentioning those who had died in faith, not yet receiving what was promised. And he's going through this list, and he says, "Others suffered mocking and flogging, even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were killed with the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, mistreated." You know what it says after that? "Of whom the world was not worthy." That's an amazing statement. Those people who suffer for Christ and give their lives for him, the world isn't even worthy of them. What a fascinating thing to consider. And that's why. Why suffer? Because it's the greatest privilege we could ever have for Christ, to share that suffering in some sense with him. Well, let's pray before we look at John 1, and it's going to be very quick tonight. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would give us the strength to suffer well, the willingness to suffer, that you would be worth everything, that we would hold nothing back, no affection, no part of our life, everything, that we would lay at your feet in submission and in worship. We pray even now as we look at John 1 for a moment and really just focus on one verse, we pray that you would be honored and glorified in this time. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So John 1. We are going to read this section of scripture, John 1, 1 through 37, and we are going to stop really at one verse. And that's it. But let's just read, and I hope you all know this. The reading of the scriptures in itself is encouraging, is it not? You don't need anybody to exegete the scriptures for you to be encouraged by the word of God read aloud. This is truly the word of the living God. So I hope even in these 37 verses that you would see it as such and see your hope in Jesus Christ. So let's start. John 1. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness, to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks before me because he was before me.' For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God who is at the Father's side. He has made him known. And this is the testimony of John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, 'Who are you?' He confessed and did not deny, but confessed, 'I am not the Christ.' And they asked him, 'What then? Are you Elijah?' He said, 'I am not.' 'Are you the prophet?' And he answered, 'No.' So they said to him, 'Who are you? We need to give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?' He said, 'I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Then why are you baptizing if you are neither the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water, but among you stands one you do not know, even he who comes after me, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie." These things took place in Bethany across the Jordan where John was baptizing. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks before me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but for this purpose I came baptizing with water that he might be revealed to Israel. And John bore witness, 'I saw the Spirit descend from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, "He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit." And I have seen and have borne witness that this is the Son of God." The next day, again, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, "Behold the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. John 1 is a wonderful passage, isn't it? So much truth. But for tonight, in the context of what we've heard, I really just wanted to focus on one verse. And it's verse 29 that was also echoed a little bit in verse 36. And it is this: "The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and said, 'Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world.'" Have you considered that statement before? How wonderful of a statement that is. We're going to break this down a little bit. That word, "behold," is not just, "Hey, take a look if you want." It's not a passing glance. It's not a brief look. It is "behold." Gaze upon, look, you, there is actually in the Greek word, it denotes, you don't want to miss this. Do not neglect it. So when John says, "Behold," he's saying, "Everyone, attention, please, you do not want to miss this." Behold who? The Lamb of God. He calls him this peculiar name, not so peculiar to us, remember, because we have the revelation of the scriptures. We can see in what sense Jesus is the Lamb of God. But to the Jew in that day, do you know how strange of a statement that would have been? To be called the Lamb of God they would have thought, why is he talking about sacrifices? Their minds would have immediately gone to bloodshed. And you can actually tell that this is the context of sacrificial language because look at what is associated with this phrase, Lamb of God. John says, behold, the Lamb of God who what? Takes away the sins of the world. Sacrificial offerings were meant to cleanse or remove sin. But of course, you all know this. There was a problem in the Old Testament sacrificial system, and it was this. Animal blood could never lastingly take away sins. It could put it off from one year to the next, but never cleanse sin. Hebrews 10:4 says it's impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. So in what sense is Jesus the Lamb of God? That passage I just read, Hebrews 10:4, there's a 10:5. It goes beyond that, and I want you to listen to this. It says this, consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said this, sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body have you prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book. When he said above, you have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings, these are offered according to the law. Then he added, behold, I have come to do your will. He does away with the first in order to establish the second. And here is the result. And by that will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. This Lamb of God is none other than Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Obviously, this statement isn't exhaustive in itself. One should behold the Lamb of God and behold unto belief, unto faith. But I really just wanted to look at this verse for a few moments because here's the truth. You and I might not be dressed like John the Baptist. We might not be eating locusts and honey. We might not have a specific prophecy made about us as a forerunner to the Messiah, but you and I are heralds of the good news. You and I ought to share this same message. Behold. You might notice this in your usual speech, right? Somebody might come up to you and say, hey, look at this. You're going to want to see this. You don't want to miss this. Wesley does this to me all the time. And it's for far less significant things. He normally says, Dada, come here. I got to show you this. It's really cool. And he'll like stick his leg in a strange way. And I'm like, wow, that was really cool. That was really cool. But it's, the reason why he says that is because it's significant to him, right? He's saying, I've got to have your attention. You're not going to want to miss this, Dad. I've got to show you something. And I love it. It's great. You might be like that with a few things as well. But are we like that with our Savior? Do we treat him in that same way where we view it as the most valuable being in the whole world that we say, behold, you've got to come see my Savior. This is Jesus Messiah, Son of the living God, the promised one, the only hope for mankind. Behold him. Behold him in the word. Behold what he's done in my life. Behold my Savior who can forgive you of your sins. Behold the Lamb of God. So in thinking of this, I just have a few comments. One, do we desire Do we desire others to see the Lamb? And I hope your answer is yes. You see, John the Baptist would eventually be beheaded, but he knew in his short amount of time here, he wanted the people to see one person. That's it. That was his life's whole purpose and goal. And I would argue that's our goal as well. We want the world to see and know the one, the Lamb of God. So do you desire that others would behold him? And if we would say, secondly, if we would say that we desire for others to know Jesus, the Lamb of God, how is that evident in our lives? And I don't say that to be cruel or harsh, but many of us would affirm, yes, we want people to know Jesus the Lamb. And when we are asked, but in what ways is that manifest in our life? We would say, oh, maybe only to this certain arena of life am I good at that. Maybe not to my neighbor or to my workplace or to my extended family. Parents, are you like that with your kids? It's okay to get excited with your kids about teaching them about Jesus. You want them to see the Lamb of God. You want your children to know their sins and how their sins separate them from God. And that's why you have to show them Jesus. Come, behold the Lamb of God. You can't miss this. Then thirdly, just something I wanted to share with you all. Pastor Brian mentioned this in our staff meeting yesterday, and I thought it was really, really good. Sometimes we are afraid to share our faith or to share the gospel because we merely view it as facts, as a bunch of strung together sentences that articulate truth or facts. And we fear that if we can't articulate the facts very well, then we won't share the gospel. But we forget that the good news is not just facts. The good news is Jesus. That takes the weight off of evangelism a little bit, doesn't it? The good news is Jesus himself, the Lamb of God. Yes, the gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ. But 1 John 1 tells us that Jesus is the word of life. He is the true eternal life. He is the message of life. We just read in John 1, in the beginning was the word. He's the word of God, the word of life. Sometimes we boil down the gospel to just a bunch of facts instead of a relationship with the Lamb, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Instead of facts, have you ever viewed sharing the gospel as simply telling someone the good news about Jesus? Who he is, what he has done for you, how your life has been changed and it will never be the same, and how the same could be true for them if they just believe? Oh, how we should evangelize with that fervor and zeal. You know, Kyle and Della and many missionary families all around the world are heralding this truth, the truth of Jesus the Messiah. One thing I love that Kyle shared was that when he tells people about his faith, he doesn't say, I believe in the gospel. He could say that. No, he says, I follow Jesus the Messiah. There's a relationship with the Most High God and the only God. What would hinder us in this city? What would hinder us in our neighborhoods of begging others to behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world? Maybe it's laziness. Maybe it's fear of rejection. Maybe it's lack of compassion where you don't even feel moved to share because you As long as you're good with the Lord, who cares if anyone else is? That's selfish. Maybe it's a lack of faith that surely they could never be saved. They're too ensnared in their sin. They'll never change. I pray that we would repent of those things. And my question to you would be this: have you not seen and tasted that the Lord is good? Have you not seen your life as a testimony of the barriers that were broken down when you saw Christ? Your life's never been the same. You look back at the old you and you see it's changed. That same truth, the message of Christ, can change a life anywhere and everywhere. Our plea, when we plea this with people, when we beg them, come behold, it's not an angry beholding, come behold or else. No, that's different than saying, behold, you can miss it. If you miss it, you're gonna miss out on everything. Just come, please, come see Jesus. Come see the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. It is a joy-filled plea. And so, I promised I would be brief, and so I'm done with that part. I would like our night to close with some specific prayer related to this. We did this a few weeks ago when the students were at camp. Some of you were in the room. We did a night of what we called attributes and prayer, and it was a sweet time. And we won't do the attributes because we don't really have time tonight, but I do want us to end in some specific ways to pray. Don't worry. It's individual. But sometimes we don't labor in prayer because maybe we don't know how to pray. Maybe we don't know how to fill our time in prayer. Maybe it's been basically our prayers are mainly like a quick thanks and a list of petitions. And sometimes it might not be the most fruitful or worshipful. But tonight I would like to spend a few moments in guided prayer. What that means is this: there's going to be different categories of prayer. There's going to be a minute where we will each spend individually at the same time confessing sin in our life, specifically related to the truth. If we are called to be heralds of the good news, to be as John the Baptist and say, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Surely, many of us, if not all of us, have failed at different times. There's going to be a prayer of confession. There's going to be a time of listening. We don't listen very well or very often. And I don't mean listening for some audible voice from the Lord, but I mean for the Spirit to work within you, to call to mind people in your life that you know need that message. There's going to be a minute of thanksgiving as well for the Lamb himself. And then lastly, and purposely so, petitioning. We get to save ourselves for last, as far as what we would ask of God. And then we will conclude with a final prayer just for Kyle and Della, and of course the family that they mentioned as well. So what we're going to do is start with confession. Again, 1 minute, and this is repenting of living in such a way where others are not beholding Jesus Christ. Confess of other things that keep your attention instead of Christ. Let's confess now. Amen. The Bible says when you confess your sins, God is faithful and just to forgive them. Confession is not a time to just bask in your sin, but to receive the forgiveness of Christ. Next, we are going to do just a minute of listening, and this is to the best of your ability where you say nothing in your mind, and that's hard to do. Truly, consider for a moment who needs to behold the Lamb of God in your life. Consider how you might be a herald of the good news for them. So let's listen. Amen. Now we will go into a minute of thanksgiving where I would just ask you if you have beheld the Lamb of God with faith and your eyes have been opened to the saving blood, do you not have much to be thankful for? Your sins have been forgiven. Righteousness foreign to you is now your own. Let's give thanks. Amen. Lastly, as you prepare to petition the Lord, to request of him, ask God that he would show you Jesus more clearly. And pray that you would be in a constant state of beholding this Lamb, of adoring Christ. Pray that you would lift up Jesus for others to behold, and pray that others would behold him and turn from their sins and receive salvation. Petition for those whom God has called to mind. Let's pray now. Let's pray together corporately. One final prayer just for Kyle and Della, and that we would behold the Lamb of God and that we would be heralds of that good news. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we do ask that you would help us to behold so many things in our life vie for those affections and attention. We behold many things, but oftentimes things that just don't matter. Help us to fix our eyes upon Jesus. And in fixing our eyes, remember what you have done for us. You have done for us what no one else could do. And you paid a heavy price. You came to bleed and die on the cross at the hands of sinful men for us. And not just for us, but for all who might receive you through faith. That is the heart of the Great Commission. We want people to know you. Because if they know you, they will love you. And when they love you, they will follow you no matter the cost. So I pray for Kyle and Della specifically in their ministry, that you would go before them, prepare minds and hearts to receive truth. When there are times of very little fruit, may they be encouraged all the more. Because you alone produce the growth. It is all of you. It is all to your glory. May they simply be faithful and unwaveringly so. Protect them. Keep them for this work. We pray for this family as well that is greatly suffering. That you would be with the wife who's left behind. Comfort her with only the comfort that you can. Thank you for the testimony of that family, the father and the children, and the legacy that they leave of gospel faithfulness, faithfulness unto the Lord. I pray that you would help us at Riverbend to know that our mission field is right before us. We just need to walk outside of our front door. It's in our neighborhoods, our workplace, our city. May we be one-track minded, and that is that people would know Jesus and that we would be unashamed. Lord, we confess there are times where we shrink back in fear because we fear man and not God. We pray that you would cast that fear so far from us that it would never return, that we would have a humble boldness, that we would be kind and gentle, but bold and truthful. Give us opportunity, we pray, but also that we would take advantage of those opportunities. We have the message. The word of life, Jesus Christ. We owe our lives to you. So help us to follow you no matter the cost. And may we shout with our lives, with our actions and our words, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. May we be a fragrant aroma to you with our lives, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I think the worship team is going to come up and close.